Welcome to Click. I'm... Welcome to... Coming soon, a chance for you to tell us exactly what you think while you're watching. This week on Click, we'll find out what happens when social networking meets television. And if you fancy making some exciting programs of your own, how about using some of this video kit? And how do you store all that lovely video you're making? Try one of these huge and huger storage devices. And finally, how to be a hero without the cape. One of this week's top site recommendations in Webscape. Welcome to Click. I'm Spencer Kelly. Have you ever seen a programme on TV that was just so good you couldn't wait to tell all your friends about it? Or one that was so bad that you just had to vent your feelings to anyone who would listen? Well, if that's you, put down your phone, switch off your laptop and close that window. Now there's a way to chat with people about the things on the TV, while they're happening. Mark Chislak is Click's most vociferous TV critic, and here he is with more.
The good old television. It's occupied a special place at the heart of the living room for nearly 75 years. All was going swimmingly for the TV. And then along came the computer, and then the internet, inviting users to not just sit back and passively watch, but to lean forward and interact. Viewers were dragged away from the magic lantern in the corner of the room and towards access to the information superhighway in the other corner of the room. But there have been strange rumblings on the web. Television audiences across the globe are sharing their viewing experiences with other people online. Nothing new there. Harking back to the notion of the whole family sat around the box, now the whole world, or at least the whole world with access to the same television programmes and a web connection, can sit around the box too. Welcome to Social TV.
Social TV is all about connecting audiences in a richer way around a great television programme.
Social TV has the potential to actually radically change the whole TV viewing experience, evolving it from a passive experience to one that's perhaps more social, interactive and personal, potentially making TV the actual place to meet people and share experiences again.
This idea of sharing the live TV experience online is nothing new. Newspapers have been running blogs dissecting live TV programmes as they happen for several years now. However, social networking services like Facebook and Twitter have recently become the social TV weapon of choice. Bespoke applications geared around sharing thoughts and views on shows have started to appear on a variety of different devices. TV Chatter is a free app for the iPhone. Users can visit a TV show's mobile site and check out and interact with that program's tweet stream. Video games consoles are getting in on the act as well. In the UK, Xbox's subscription-based streaming TV tie-up with Sky includes the option to watch entire programmes with online friends and interact via avatars and voice chat. The emote system allows these avatars to express particular emotions as a result of the on-screen action. Unfortunately, my avatar is something of a Billy No-Mates. Not much different from when I normally watch TV then.
Emoticons and text have pretty much been the current preferred communications method for social TV. But I think what's happening is that we're actually pushing that to provide perhaps a more comprehensive communication suite. So we started out with things like, dislike, I don't know types of systems, and now pushing forward to use text messaging and comments.
Boxy takes a slightly different approach. It started life as an online social media service for use with a PC or Apple TV. Deals have been struck with US content providers. When a user logs in, TV shows, movies, pictures and music can be recommended by other users. And if that content's available for legal download, it can be shared with friends. This idea has migrated away from the computer. Boxy have created a separate device which plugs directly into the TV. So far, all of these experiences seem a bit text-heavy, though.
At the end of the day, it could also involve sharing things through audio or visual communication even. I think probably audio is the most interesting, because if someone's about to score a goal or something's happening, you really want to scream out loud or enjoy that excitement with people.
We have Skype TV coming out in a few months from now. I think that's radically going to change how people perceive video conferencing, and it's going to be interesting to see how that actually links through to social TV.
But all of these experiences make use of devices other than the TV. More and more televisions have emerged that can be connected to the internet. These TVs allow limited web access through use of widgets, simple cut-down versions of web services optimized for use with a remote control. US telecoms company Verizon has already introduced social media and social TV functionality into its Fios TV system.
But surely, the thoughts of viewers across the world and extra information flashing up on screen might actually interfere with the television programme you're trying to watch.
Having more than one device to provide a social TV experience may be a better experience for people. People have already been slightly jarred with simply having, if you like, over-the-top widget engines actually being integrated in the television set. But actually being able to use multiple devices, keeping the TV shared, and having your own personal either laptop open or your mobile phone that provides that social TV layer might be the way we want to go.
A recent US survey concluded that 60% of Americans surf the web while watching TV. With so many viewers already online and enjoying television programs at the same time, the potential for the social TV experience to cross over to the mainstream is clear.
Mark Chislak. And if there's anything you'd like to get off your chest about that or anything else you see today, well, feel free to chat amongst yourselves or email us. Click at bbc.co.uk is the address. And on Twitter, we are at bbcclick. Now, a brief look at some of the big tech stories hitting the wires this week.
Plenty of unrest in Apple's orchard ahead of this weekend's iPad release. Developers are preparing to charge more for iPad apps than its little iPod brother. A game like Animatch, for example, sells for 99 cents on the touch, but the planned price for the bigger Apple is $1.99. As developers can't actually get their hands on an iPad until everyone else, the 1,000 new iPad apps available on launch day might be suffering from some growing pains. Freeview and Channel 4 join the Beeb this week in broadcasting high definition for free. 4.5 million homes will be able to receive Freeview HD. It's hoped coverage will extend to half the UK population in time for the World Cup. Sony's preempting possible piracy by locking down its PS3. Older models had an option to install an alternative operating system. But after the infamous iPhone unlocker GeoHot, aka George Hotz, claimed to bypass the console's security systems, Sony's rolled out an optional update on the 1st of April that dispenses with the other OS feature. They're no April Fools, but there were plenty of attempts to make fools out of the rest of us on April the 1st, like Google claiming that a human will alert you every time you receive an update to a new Google Wave. A clutch of iPad-related ruses too, like European regulators enforcing a redesign of the tablet because its edges are too sharp, The Times reporting that it wants to make it more like a ball so it can be rolled from user to user.
Now then, here on Click, we're always advising you to back up your important data should the worst happen. Problem is, with all the videos and photos and music tracks that we have on our machines nowadays, we need more and more space to back this stuff up too. So, I thought I'd show you a few storage and backup options today that you may not have seen before. This first one looks like a credit card, and it is designed to fit in your wallet, but it is actually 32 gigabytes of, as the name suggests, click-free backup. You flip out the little USB plug there and connect it to your machine. At that point, software on the card automatically runs and backs up anything that you've previously set it up to save. You can customize it, and it is an incremental backup, which means it doesn't save everything every time, only the stuff that's changed. Now, the only thing about these really lightweight USB connectors is they do seem a bit flimsy to me, and you don't even get the whole USB connector, only half of it. I have been known to put these in upside down by accident before, but don't tell anyone, will you? Now, if you want more than 32 gig, maybe I can interest you in 64. Now, this is a PCI Express card with 64 gigabytes of storage on, which means if you have the correct slot on your laptop, you just pop it in like that, and it shows up as an external hard drive. A couple of good things about this. First of all, it fits within the footprint of your laptop, so there's nothing left hanging out that you can accidentally knock. And also, the connection inside the laptop is really fast, because you're basically plugging it right into the brains of the machine. What? You want more than 64 gig? All right, how about 128? Now, this is a solid-state hard drive that's designed to go inside your laptop. You can also fit it inside a desktop machine. It comes with a couple of adapters to fit it into a bigger slot. And what you do is you first of all put it in this caddy, which temporarily turns it into a USB external hard drive. Plug it into your machine, and then you can clone everything that's on your existing hard drive onto this. Then you unplug this and take it out of the caddy, swap the hard drives, and there's all your existing data on your new bigger, faster hard drive. You can keep your old laptop hard drive in the caddy and use it as an external drive if you fancy. You want more storage in a smaller space so you can fit it inside that little pocket in your skinny jeans. Right then, how about this? Now this is a USB keyring with, go on, guess how much storage? Go on. Yeah, 256 gig, which sounds pretty incredible, doesn't it? The only thing more incredible than that is the price tag. Oh, and one more thing that's even more impressive is that next year we'll probably be sitting here talking about numbers even bigger than that. Last week we looked at the video cameras and video technology that could help you capture perfect pictures every time and then share them with just about everyone. This week, Ian Hardy is back with more video on video. And if your camera's always been a bit too big and bulky to capture some of your more extreme exploits, this next lot could be for you.
Until recently, if you'd wanted to throw yourself off a cliff and film it at the same time in the highest HD quality, you'd have needed a rather large camcorder and a pretty reliable way of strapping it to your head. Even the slightest little bump at the bottom could have cost thousands of dollars in camera repairs. But now, for just $300, you can get a small 1080p camcorder encased in a waterproof clear polycarbonate shell.
Super versatile. You've got all sorts of options for mounting it on cars, motorcycles, bikes, skateboards, surfboards. Skydivers are using it. You know, it depends on the perspective you want to see. But the cool thing is you can move it around super easily and get lots of different angles of whatever sport you like to do.
Underwater filming used to be doubly challenging. Not only did you need a big waterproof housing for the camera, but also a substantial lighting rig that was awkward for novice divers, but necessary to bring out colour beneath the surface. So one company has put an HD wide-angle camera in a scuba mask, capable of recording 32 gigabytes of data onto a micro SD card, and then integrated a modern lighting solution.
On either side of the mask, you can add a high-powered LED light. We have 4.7-watt lights, and so then the lights are in line with your video, and they really create a nice, broad, soft light. It's not a hot spot. And these super high-powered LED lights are fantastic. They make the video amazing.
These cameras are fine for capturing one vantage point at any given moment, but what if you want to see two angles at the same time, say a roller coaster ride, recording your face and the view in front simultaneously? The Ion Twin video camera has lenses on both sides that write separate HD video streams to the same memory card. And of course, as every video enthusiast knows, sound is also important.
We're an audio company first and foremost, even though we're doing video as well. And so our audio expertise allows us to create very high quality recording capabilities for both front and back of the camera. So you've got a stereo coincident pair of microphones on the front and back, so you get a nice stereo spread and really good audio reproduction, unlike some of the other handheld video cameras that are out there now.
One major improvement with almost all video cameras in this genre is compatibility. For years, many devices only worked with Windows, but for consumers, that's no longer acceptable, which is why the Trio PenCam HD has cross-platform connectivity and rejected a file format like Windows Media.
If you do a video camcorder, you better make sure that it's compatible with Mac. You know, so for us, we thought, hey, well, let's do a .mov format, which is going to work with both a Mac and a PC, and really simplify it for everybody. You know, if they want to do video editing, they can do it on both platforms.
As components become cheaper and cheaper, yet at the same time more flexible and more powerful, we'll start to see a whole new range of uses for video hardware. This, for example, could be used as a digital signboard. It plays up to 2 gigabytes worth of video files continuously for up to 10 hours on a vivid OLED display. Some firms are reinventing their hardware, especially security companies. Spy pens and other types of undercover cameras are proving to be popular amongst the social networking crowd. So expect to see a splash of color and maybe some patterns on gear like this before year's end.
I think it's a challenge for Swan as a security company to make its products hip and I guess cool and fun. And we definitely have to do that now to make sure our products look fashionable and I guess appealing to teenagers and to kids, because that is becoming a bigger market for us.
Super compact video cameras are everywhere, and cell phone lenses and chips are only getting better and better. But a lot of the smaller devices lack image stabilization, commonly found on bigger models. That's where software like V-Reveal comes in handy.
Unfortunately, it's not easy to look at because it's wobbling around like this. Again, making it very easy to address this, I'm just gonna hit the stabilize button and bam. Now that's nice and steady, and I'm doing that all on the fly so I can preview and see what my video is going to look like when I apply these enhancements. So again, here's your before, you know, shaky, and here's your after on the right. Before and after, so that's nice and steady.
The software works by looking at each frame and comparing it to surrounding frames. Anything moving erratically is picked up by multi-frame motion detection, and the entire movement is smoothed out. Until image stabilization on the smallest devices is commonplace, software may be the best way of making your footage look good, no matter how high or how fast you have to go to get it.
And that was Ian Hardy. Now, earlier we talked about how TV was getting more social and catching up with social networking on the web. And of course, these days you get the chance to tell everyone what's happening and what's on your mind. But with social networks hitting smartphones too, the new question on everyone's virtual lips is, where are you? Kate, where are you?
I am here. The rampant success of the smartphone has seen a sharp rise in the number of location-aware apps, which use GPS to customise the user's experience as they move about the planet. Perhaps the best-known social media app of this type today is Foursquare. Available across multiple mobile platforms, the idea is to check in when you arrive somewhere, like a cafe or a bar, and leave advice about the venue, such as a good table to sit at or the best cocktail on the menu. To encourage participation, the developers have added a clever competitive twist, where you gain points and accolades for your input. If you check in the most regularly at a particular location, you become its mayor, which in some cases can equate to a discount or a free drink. Sadly, you don't get a shiny chain and a fancy hat to wear. Not unless you make one yourself. This competitive aspect means the content is being added very rapidly. So when you're out and about and looking for a good place to settle for a few hours, you can use the app to bring up local suggestions. You can even use it to find a bit of company, as linking to Facebook and Twitter helps you find friends on Foursquare super easily, and then you can see if anyone is nearby. Do be aware of the privacy issues around location sharing apps though, and choose the network you invite and where you choose to broadcast your check-ins wisely. It seems like nearly everyone has a blog these days. You might fancy starting one up yourself, but if you're the kind of person who's only just got used to email, the idea can be daunting. Not if you look at Postgres.com. Here, the act of blogging is as easy as sending an email. No setup required. Just mail what you want to post to the posterous address and the site will automatically set you up with your own custom URL. You can send text, videos, MP3s, all sorts of files. And this helpful little web tool will pop them all in your blog. No mess, no fuss, no technical know-how required. And you can even link your page to a raft of social media platforms, making sharing your news with the world super easy. With additional features like built-in comments, live blogging from your mobile, and even Google Analytics to help you understand your web traffic, this simple concept can actually be quite a powerful blogging aid if you push it to its boundaries. Now you have no excuse not to start talking to the world. And if you have something important to say, you could become a hero of your very own film, like me in this one. Okay, so I'm not really a hero. This is actually a viral produced by the Swedish government to encourage people to pay their TV licence, of all things. Once your picture is uploaded into the system, you get integrated really impressively into the action. You appear in photo frames, billboards, even clipped to a notepad floating around in space. It's the closest most of us will get to global fame. So share it with your friends and family or embed it in your blog to get people talking. With advertisers looking for ways to grab our attention, this is a really great example of some creative thinking which sucks the viewer in. If you'd rather watch a film than star in it, check out ChineseFilms.cn. This is the new English language website for China's state-run film bureau, where you'll find trailers, interviews and updates on productions in progress. It's a fascinating glimpse inside the country's traditionally closed culture and makes a refreshing change from all the negative stories surrounding China and the internet recently.
I stood up. I said a prayer, and I stepped off.
Also hitting the headlines, RedBullStratos.com, where you can read all about skydiver Felix Baumgartner's planned attempt to break a 50-year-old world record by jumping out of a balloon from the edge of space. This week, the science team revealed the suit and helmet, which will be crucial to Felix surviving the attempt as he becomes the first person to break the sound barrier without the aid of a machine on his 37-kilometre journey back to Earth.
It's an area that is very hostile to man. I think Felix feels it.
Kate Russell. Now, we're always on the lookout for great sites and apps to feature on Webscape. So if you know of something that we should be talking about, email click@bbc.co.uk or tweet us @bbcclick. Right, we're off until next week. If you miss us in the meantime, head on over to our website. bbc.co.uk/click contains a video stream of this show and a bunch of brand new video games reviews which are exclusive to the main site and the mobile site. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.